Awesome. So I wanted to share something a bit more unusual. There won't be a lot of slides. It's just a few intro slides, because then I will be digging into more of the code of things. So who is using Chocolaty here? Who is familiar with Chocolaty? There's one person.
Little vaguely aware it exists.
Okay.
Never used it.
Cool. Then let's quickly go over to my browser. So, Chocolaty is a package manager for Windows. So, who has used Linux here? They're usually like RPM, Yum, apt. So, basically, the guy who developed this, he had the same thing. There wasn't really a package manager for Windows. So, you basically developed something which was very similar to the ones you know on Linux, where there's a package somewhere and you install it, and it's not MSI necessarily. So he created a thing, and as you can see with the demo in the corner, you can have a command line and you install a package, you uninstall it, you upgrade it. So it's like a consistent experience. It's not like, okay, you need to double click on this .exe file or on this MSI file. It's a consistent experience. And because it's a command line utility, you can also automate it. And they're actually, because it's a command line utility, with tools like DC, Chef, Puppet, Ansible, you can actually run Chocolaty on a machine and install packages. So it's a very nice package manager, and it's sort of, you know, MSIs, you know, .exe files, and they're usually very difficult to install because there are some arguments you need to give it, or if you want to install it silently, every install or a lot of them are very different. If it's an install shell, you need these arguments. If it's an InnoDB, is it this? And this one basically gives you a utility where you can encapsulate it for the user. So they only enter, say, a Choco install Docker. They don't need to know all the intrinsic detail behind how to install this particular tool. And it's also a nice tool to, if you have like your workstation or laptop at work or at home, if you do a reinstall, just to get your software back instead of going, okay, need to go to Google Chrome, install Chrome, or go to Firefox, or go to this website. You go to this website, and you go into the install page, and just either copy the command line thing here, becomes a complete thing, or if you already have a PowerShell open as an admin, you just copy the PowerShell line, and then it installs everything you need for Chocolaty. And once you have it running, then you can do what you could see on the first screen, Choco install Docker. And if you don't know what kind of packages are out there, there's sort of a community like the PowerShell Gallery, where the community publishes packages for all sorts of software we use day to day. As you can see, Chocolaty itself, Acrobat Reader, Flash, Google Chrome. So there are lots of things, Firefox, 7-Serve, so all the stuff you already know and probably love, a lot of them, you can easily install with just a command line thing. In the background, it hides the actual complexity of installing it, of downloading it, and so on.
So I guess from like a user perspective, they could like call something like click on something and it would just render it from the background.
Yep.
Install, yeah.
Yep. So it's a very nice thing, especially for us as IT geeks. I find it where I use it all the time to basically install software I need. So if I go into my console here and I say Choco list local only, you get all the software I've installed on my machine using Chocolaty. There are a few things. I mean, that's not everything, but there are a few things I've installed using Chocolaty. And that gets me up and running really quickly. If you get a new laptop and it's fresh and vanilla, that's really quickly, especially installing Chrome and other stuff. So I find it really helpful. And you can get very complex. There's on this community thing, you can there's like Visual Studio and then all sorts of flavors here with patches and distributables. So it's it's very comprehensive. And the nice thing about this community repository is actually the MSI or EXE file is usually stored at the original place of an ETH publisher. So if it's a Microsoft EXE, it's the actual download comes from Microsoft, but the logic is in the package which is uploaded to this this repository. And this one is actually orchestrated, basically. If someone uploads a package for something, a maintainer, a moderator looks at the package, installs it, and checks everything, if everything is okay, before actually approving it for it, so you can see it. So it's a pretty...
So anyone like loads property, like a stock,
Yeah, you can publish these packages,
yeah.
And because it's a community feed, there is a moderator or several moderators behind it, so your package won't show up immediately.
Yeah.
They're going to install it, look at your code to before they approve. So it's a pretty safe environment these days. In the early days, everyone could push their packages, and it wasn't monitored really, but a few years ago, I think after it got really popular with a lot of people, then they started to have a team of moderators looking into this really. So I find it's a really safe place to install your software. So that's why, just to set the stage, that's Chocolaty. And now you might be wondering how the hell I'm going to create a Chocolaty package after I installed it. And I'm going to show this to you. It's super easy. And they give you a lot of help on the hand as well. So if I go into my development folder for Chocolaty, I already have a demo version in here, which I'm going to show because I stripped a lot out what you're going to see in a moment, just to the basics. But it's really easy. You say just Choco, new. And you say, okay, well, what application I'm going to package? It could be something you might download from the internet, but it could also be an internal application. Some of your developers, they maybe want to deploy a website, or they have written some VB application which you need to deploy, but at the moment there is not really an installer. They just give you a zip file, and then they say, huh? They throw it over the wall, basically, as the old saying, and then you need to figure out what to do with it. That's a good tool to basically leverage to use the zip file and then install it on as many machines, desktops, servers, where you want. So you say Choco new, and in this case I say RoyalTS version 4, for example. And this one basically creates a folder structure. You can see it created a new folder. And if I open this in VS Code, which is my favorite tool for editing, it basically scaffolds a basic package for you. And one of the files in there is a XML file, which is a standard NewSpec file. And it's you strip out the comments. That's what I've done in the demo. And then you replace all the stuff, the version number and all these kind of things. But the nice thing about how they've done this with the scaffolding, the comments are there for you to get an understanding what you need to put into this file, what's required, what's optional. So it's a very nice way that you can actually just choco new, you go in there and you read all the comments and you slowly get started with the packaging. So there's a lot of information in there. A lot of that is basically used on this gallery, on this public, but you can also host your own. So like the links to things or the description, all of these things are beneficial for the user consuming the package later. So basically replace all these things. And then you might wonder now, how the hell is this going to install something? So what you have is you have a tools folder here, and there's where the PowerShell comes in. So there are three different files. One is absolutely mandatory, the other ones are optional. So the file which is obviously mandatory to install the application, you have this PS1 file to install. And then if for whatever reason you want to offer an uninstall, like getting rid of a folder or uninstalling MSI or EXE, you can add this. It depends really on your use case. the community packages, most of them have an uninstaller because people might want to get rid of this. In an internal situation, it might not be necessary. If you always install a vanilla box, install something, and if you want to make a change, you get a new box, it is not really necessary to create an uninstall. So it really depends on your situation for internal packages. Of course, for something you might want to publish to the community, then uninstall is, of course, really necessary because people want to get rid of it. And then the other one, the before modify, is basically if your software has like a feature where you can update it, where you can add a feature to it, like a SQL Server or Visual Studio, then you can use this first script basically before the modification happens and do something on the box. You maybe need to stage some files or whatever. So this gives you the ability, but it's not necessary. The only one which is absolutely necessary is the install, because we want to install things. And this one is also heavily documented with comments. So it tells you basically almost everything you need to know how to modify the script so your application gets installed. So at the beginning, it basically starts here. So you have the URL. So in this case, the idea is that you download the MSI or Axios zip file from somewhere, either a public source or your internal web server. And then you create a hash table. Who's familiar with hash tables and splatting in PowerShell? Okay, we need to cover this at some point. I'll show you at some point. So you create a hash table, and this hash table basically has all the properties the function we are going to call later needs, the minimum it needs to work. So you basically replace what's necessary. You replace, you say it's an ACSI, MSI, or MSU, and the logic they put into the function, which you will see in a moment, it will deal with these intrinsic differences, how I invoke an MSI or how I invoke an ACSI file. So it basically hides a lot of the complexity of that. And then it also has a checksum thing. So it downloads the file and then does a checksum. So you, especially for the community stuff, it's really important that you download the file they test it against. If the author updates the file and the checksum doesn't match anymore, you know something has happened. Someone might have tampered with the package, with the actual installation. So it's a very good way to make sure what you expect is also going to be installed. And then you can see you give it the silent arguments. You can deal with the exit codes. If let's say you have like an ACSI installer and has some weird exit codes, you can make sure you deal with them correctly. And as you can see, there are lots of different examples they give, just to give you an idea if you're not too familiar with packaging. And then literally, what does the installation is this function, install chocolatey package. And it basically you give it this hash table and it populates all the arguments of this function. So that's basically a very simple way of doing it. You just download an ACSI, like an install child installer, figure out the silent arguments, and usually it's a /s or something. And then you install it. But there are also other functions in there which I'm going to show you in a moment. You can, if you get a zip file, you can just install a zip file. So you don't need to do a download. You could.
About the extraction or anything?
It happens automatically. It deals with it in the background automatically. So there are helper functions which I'm going to show you in a moment as well, which help you with certain things. And because it's a PowerShell script, you can get as complex as you want with this. So if you have like a one book how to install a certain application, like a Word document from the old days, and it says you need to create a folder there, you need to create like maybe an XML file or JSON file or INI file in this format, you can do this in this PowerShell script, and then copy maybe some files from a file share or wherever, just to make sure this application gets installed. So because it's a PowerShell script, it can be as complex as you want. You can query a REST endpoint to get some information you might need for this machine. So just imagine the possibilities with using this PowerShell script. So there are lots of functions in there which you can use to make it. This particular one, which is as default, is basically getting something from a web server and install it. But there are lots of other functions which help you to basically craft a script for all sorts of scenarios. So that's what it's just the basics. I'm not going to do a package here, but to show you basically how this looks. And if I open the other one, like my demo one, you can basically see once I stripped out all the comments, it's just a nicely formatted XML file. And if you want, you could generate them. And then I go into the install one and I stripped out most of the comments. And you see the file is really short, just to install, in this case, an MSI. And I gave it the URL where to download the file, and it can be 32-bit, 64-bit. If you have an app which has different installation files, the install function will figure out I'm running on a 32-bit or 64-bit system, and then download the appropriate version and install it. This is very easy, and as you can see, I also put in the hash for it to make sure I download the version I expected, the extra file. So that's how it basically looks. And then to create the package is super easy. You basically, you're in the folder where in the root folder of your package, and you say choco pack. And then you can see it created a new pack file, but the new pack file is just a zip file. So if I rename this to zip, and I open my Explorer here, then I have just a zip file with some stuff in there. So the tools, the install. So it's nicely done. It's very easy to use. And then what the next command you would use, I can't demo this yet at the moment because I don't have the server running. You say choco push, and you give it a source, which is in this case the destination, where you push it up. So you push it up to one of these repos, and you can, something like this, you can host internally as well. There is a software, there's a free version, but there's also a paid version. It's called ProGet, and that's really easy to install. You just install it, open a web portal, and you can create a repository where you push the stuff to. So it's very easy, but there's also free versions of a chocolatey server, and very easy to use as well. So just host it in IIS. So as we can see, there's some PowerShell in there. What I wanted to show you, that's why I named this session under the hood, is the basic version of chocolatey is actually open source. So the Choco XE I showed you earlier, you can actually find the source code on GitHub. If you go to chocolatey, and the repo is named Choco. So you can download the whole source code for this application. There are only a few other components. They have basically like a free version, a community version, and also a business version. And the business version is, of course, not the additional functionality is not published yet, of course. But the main functionality you need is in here. And what you might not know is the application itself, Choco, is written in C#. It's a .NET application. But there's some way it interacts with PowerShell, because you saw it as a zip file, and in the zip file there's a PowerShell script. So how does it interact with this PowerShell script? How does it deal with that? So what I've done, I've of course downloaded this repo with a Git clone. And as you can see here, let me close this for a moment. I basically downloaded this, and there are some sources in here. And what I want to basically show you guys is basically the main application is in the infrastructure app folder, which I found out. I mean, I've also been always basically discovering how this works. My intention was to just look under the hood and see how this works, what is going on. And then I found out, which was quite surprising actually, which I haven't looked into. There's some Python in here. So the author at some point also wanted to do something with Python packages. I haven't looked into the details why the functionality is in there, but apparently you can do something with Python packages. It interacts with Ruby gems, which are Ruby packages. Not, I have no idea why. I haven't really looked into the detail. And then it can interact with the web platform installer that Microsoft publishes, and also with Windows features. So I'm not quite sure why this functionality is in there, because most of the time we use the PowerShell functionality. So they're using PowerShell in a different way, and that's something I wanted to show you on a slide. Because what you need to know about PowerShell, PowerShell is basically a library which you can get into your application, invoke in your application, and run PowerShell. So basically, when you open the ISE, for example, or PowerShell console, what happens is a library is being loaded into that process, and then PowerShell is available for usage. So there isn't really like a PowerShell exe, which has only PowerShell embedded. It's a library which is being embedded into a process. So it's either the PowerShell exe, which hosts a PowerShell session, or is an ISE or VS Code. So, and with that concept, it makes it possible because it's a library you pull into your application. It can be hosted in other applications as well. For example, like Chocolaty. So the Chocolaty application is hosting a PowerShell within the application. Another example, I'm not sure if you heard of Appware. It's a testing thing on the web. The agent running on this VM in Appware where you test the software is also a PowerShell host. So it pulls in this library, hosts PowerShell in there, and then executes a PowerShell script. Oops, sorry. Night mode. So, and you basically, you have you have the host process, which can be any basically Windows runtime, and even these days, because it's PowerShell core, it can also be a Linux executable or Mac. And then what you can create, in this case is very simplified, you create a OneSpace. Some of you might have heard about OneSpaces. So the OneSpace, as a Microsoft employee just explained, is that the summit is basically like a session. And you can, as you can see, you can have variables in the environments, you can load modules and all these things. So you deal with this OneSpace. Just to give you an idea. So if we look for this thing, and so, okay, we know it's a OneSpace, and if we search for what is called, in this case, it's called a OneSpace factory. So what it does is it uses library to create this OneSpace in the application, which is a separate thread on in the system at this point. Then you open it, and as you can see, it creates a pipeline. So it does a lot of the scaffolding you're not aware of if you just open PowerShell.exe. It creates a pipeline, and then it starts to populate the pipeline with stuff. So first it makes sure, okay, it can capture the output that is happening on the pipeline. It can do something with it. Then it deals with the errors as well. So it makes sure, okay, Chocolaty can intercept the output and the error messages and give you something on the screen in a meaningful way or in a log file. And then it starts to do stuff. So it adds commands. So something you would basically do on the command line, it does it here programmatically. It adds a script, for example. In this case, it adds a profile script. But it does also much more. There's obviously some redirections and something isn't working in certain versions of PowerShell. So they added some stuff so to make it work. So it adds another script here. Then it runs some stuff. And here you can actually, here is the actual magic. So what it does in the background, this PowerShell script you've seen, it loads it into memory. So it opens the file and reads the whole thing. And then the script is available to run. It's like a huge string, huge. So it adds the string to the commands, and the command to run is a web version. So there is some scaffolding going on here as well. Is it at the beginning? Yeah. So it wraps the script in another script basically, because there's a lot more going on. So because to capture the output of certain things, you need to wrap a PowerShell script and you need to do some special stuff. So that's basically what's happening. It loads the file and then it does some wrapping, and then it injects it as a command into this one space, into this pipeline. And then the simple thing it does, invokes it. It invokes it and it runs in the background, and then all the magic is happening. The output is being streamed to Chocolaty to deal with the output, to put it into a log file, and any errors will be dealt with. That's the basic thing what is basically doing. Of course, if you look at for example, this function, wrap the script here, if I go into the function itself, there's a lot more going on in there. So there, and that's something I want to highlight. There are some PowerShell modules. So it's actually, there's a, on the disk, which I can show you in a moment, there are PowerShell modules, which this one is basically for the install process, but there's also another one which is quite nice, which you can use in your day-to-day life. And I'm going to show you that right now. So if I do Choco, you see there is no real tap from completion here. So I would need to know, okay, there's
a... Yeah, that's what it lasts. Does it do that automatically within the script, or do you have to...
If you load the correct module, yeah, it does it automatically. So maybe I don't know as a user that there's a how to get help or there's a new function. But what you can do is, because Chocolaty by default installs into program data, and there's a helpers directory, which has this installer, which we are not going to import because it's only being imported when you install something. But there's also one which is called profile. So you could put this import statement into your profile, and when you open your PowerShell or ISE, then the profile is loaded. And then it gets nice as a user, because then you can tap complete.
There we go.
And
more like it.
And it's several layers as well. So if I do install, you can go through all the different parameters the application has. It's quite a nice module. If you are working frequently with Chocolaty, import this profile module, and it makes it a bit easier on tap completion. It's quite nice. So as we've seen this, and then we have the installer module. And I basically loaded the folder where Chocolaty is installed. And yeah, they're a helper. And basically what this one is doing, it's basically just importing the PowerShell files in the functions folder here. It's really simple. And as you can see, there are lots of PowerShell functions which are available to you in the script you saw, which you package with your if you put into your package. There are lots of different helper functions you can use, and they're also very well documented. Let's say you have that sort of scenario where you need to get a file from somewhere. There is a very well documented function to get a web file from somewhere. And it uses a lot of the same arguments of the checksum and make sure your stuff is fine and is super documented. So there are a lot of different functionalities you can see. As you can see, unzip. You can, if you need to unzip something for whatever reason, maybe there's multiple layers in that file, then you can, in your install PS1, you can use this unzip functionality and then dive deeper. And all these functions, there are two kinds of functions. There are functions you should use, and there are also low-level functions which are being called under the hood. Yeah. So you need to read up on this on the website. But you can, if you look into some of the functions, for example, web file here, when I open this one, it says it actually at the top somewhere. Yeah, here. So in the notes, it says this is a low-level function, and you shouldn't use this directly in your script. You should use the like the public version of the of this, which is the chocolatey web file. So there's a lot of things in here, but you can also see the other public functions here. Install a package. And as you can see, it's a very long one. Most of it is actually, as you can see from here, most of it is actually the comment-based help.
Yeah, yeah.
And then this is the actual function. This is the, because it's signed, so you can't easily tamper with it.
Yeah.
So it's, and what I like about it is even if you are relatively new to PowerShell, and you just want to see some code which is written in a relatively nice way.
Yep.
It's not, I wouldn't say it's completely, everything is best practice, but it's
it's nice to follow.
It's nice to follow, and you understand, okay, this function wants to install something. You start to learn how a more experienced PowerShell person deals with certain things. So I find this actually quite nice as a, I'm not a newbie, of course, but I like to read code from other people and try to understand what they're doing. So it's quite a nice way. You install this unassuming command line application, but it brings you a whole lot of PowerShell knowledge as well, which you can dig into and can understand, okay, he's doing this. It's open source, so we can copy and paste this. So if you need certain parts of it, just copy and paste it and use it in your own stuff. So, how to do the debugging, how to handle warnings, that's quite nice, or outputs. So this is a quite nice way, I find, to learn PowerShell from other people.
Yeah, I'm sure that I don't want to recreate the wheel. Someone's done it before.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Thanks very much. I look at that.
Of course, you can do that, yeah. But it's a nice way to learn how other people are doing it. That's what I like about basically all the whole open source thing, where you can look into things. Because before PowerShell was an open source, you needed to use other tools to dig into what's actually happening in the background. These days, it's much easier with a lot of things being open source. Yeah, that's what I wanted to show you. So there, the PowerShell underneath, they have a lot of interesting things happening. And the Choco itself, there are basically two modes in it. If you do an install, and then I do a help here. I mean, there are lots of help on these as well, how to use everything. There are basically two different modes. There's what I mostly explained is there is the PowerShell is being hosted in this executable and this process. But for whatever compatibility reasons, it might not be possible. Then there's a switch on here where you can say use an external PowerShell exe. So there are basically two ways to execute depending on the scenario. I don't know what the scenario would be where you would use the external one, but there might be some edge case, and they wanted to cover this edge case where you can specify this argument where it says, don't use PowerShell. You can skip PowerShell completely if you want, but there's another argument where you can say you want to use something else. Well, maybe it's an argument. So. Yeah, so there are different ways of doing this. So this, I find this is quite a nice way to install software in general. And as I said, you can integrate it in a lots of systems. DSC has a module which you can use. Chef is actually built in, for example, if you use Chef as a configuration manager, it's built in. I think Puppet is also built in, so you just need the agent, and you can start using Chocolatey in the background. This is a really nice way to maintain your packages. And even I would use I had an argument a debate about SCCM. I would even use this with SCCM, because with SCCM is always a bit funky how to create these applications. So in this case, you can just create a very simple PowerShell script which you hook into your SCCM application, and that deals with calling Chocolatey, and Chocolatey then deals with getting the package from somewhere. Because as you're probably aware, the package distribution in SCCM is not really good.
That's not gonna say
Yeah, so the in this case, you can make sure if you publish this NuGet package, including the executable somewhere, you can make sure it can be highly available on some web service around. You could put it on an Azure AWS storage somewhere or somewhere internally. So it's much more resilient in a way than, for example, SCCM with the package distribution. So I had this debate that I would use this with SCCM as well. Just create the minimum script for the application. And usually if it's really small, it gets distributed really easily. As soon as you start making it bigger, then you run into all sorts of problems. But if it's only 1 or 2K, usually works quite well with SCCM.
So can I see a big favor? Should we go back to kind of take a picture of the original install thing we get? I'm not.
Sure.
Yeah, sorry. I apologize.
No, it's okay.
I take pictures. So it makes it easier for me.
Yeah, it's okay. And then if you want to take a picture of the install page, basically, where you have the different flavors, how to install it.
Why not? Never take too many pictures.
When you run out of memory.
There you go.
Cool, awesome. Yeah, I hope it opened your eyes a little bit, what is happening around in the background. I used a similar... I used a similar concept with this hosting at a client. So at my previous client, I was sort of creating like a provisioning application for their stack. So that previously they had a Node.js backend, which was orchestrating Terraform and Octopus deploy and other things, but it was really unreliable. So I replaced the whole thing with a C# application. And because I had a lot of PowerShell scripts already, and I didn't want to transfer them into C#, which can be really difficult to compare to transfer something with your nice commandlets you've used, you're familiar, and then trying to move this into a native C# application, I thought, oh, nah. I write the PowerShell script, I get it tested, and then I wanted, let's host a PowerShell in my application when I need it. So I basically did the same thing as Chocolate is doing here. I host PowerShell in my application and I was running it when I need it. I was maybe invoking some Terraform, which is just a straight shell call. But then I needed to invoke some PowerShell maybe to interact with a REST API. And because, as you know, REST APIs are really easy to interact with in PowerShell, I'd rather use the PowerShell script to interact with then going down the road of trying to interact with REST APIs using the C# stuff, because that's like this much of code instead of just one line, invoke REST method or something like that. So it can be very valuable. Maybe you have some developers and they need to do some scaffolding or bootstrapping for their applications. You could inspire them to host the PowerShell stuff in the application. It can be a web application running in IIS. It can be just a normal service or just a normal application with a UI. It can basically in the background, you can host PowerShell and can do stuff. So that's what I wanted to show you. I hope you enjoyed it. Yeah. Any questions? Cool.
I'm going to have to look
at the shop. Yeah, that's what.
That's why I have to go back to the beginning so I can just get it.
Yeah, I really like it. It's the idea is good. I mean, it's completely free. Only if you want certain features, let's say you can do it. You can create it yourself. Let's say you're relying on Google Chrome for your internal environment. You may be spinning up some terminal servers, and of course the this is hosted on the internet, and maybe you don't have internet access, or your internet access is not reliable, or you want to just make sure you can always install this because maybe it's spinning up automatically. It's these kind of machines.
So how does this work with like DSC? Can we kind of like integrate it, or is there something we have to put on top? Or
what do you mean?
So what I mean is, okay, you build your server. Say for example, I'm going to build a server right now. and I want to basically use this to manage like packages that I put in there.
So what you would need to do is you would need to have the chocolatey resource module available to you from the configuration. So you need to host, which is a bit of a downside for DLC. You need this resource module which knows how to call chocolatey from the command line. So you need to have your configuration, you need to have this module installed on the machine, and then you can reference...
But it can be done though.
It can be done. Yeah, it can be done. I'm just saying with Chef and I think with Puppet, it's easier because it's already built in. When you install the agent, it's already there. And if you want, we can have a quick look.
Sorry,
no, it's okay. That's
introduces everything completely internalized. All the software. So Microsoft installs, anybody's installed, running on a server, and do this without any internet at all.
Yeah.
What about doing full machine
builds? It's not, I think the tool is part of the solution. So you would need something, let's say you have a vanilla image of Windows.
Yeah.
You need something to run a PowerShell script at some point. A lot of, most of the providers like Azure, you have like a startup script, or on AWS, you have this user data. So you can run some stuff. And then as part of that, for example, let's say I know AWS very well. So you have this user data and you can put in a whole PowerShell script in there, which could be just the one line at the beginning here to install it. But you have to, because you're already running in PowerShell, so you could have just this line in there to install chocolatey.
Yeah.
And then the next few commands can be choco install, choco install, choco install, choco install,
install. Okay, okay.
So, nice. Yeah. So you could basically, in that sense, bootstrap it very, very quickly.
Yeah,
but,
so rather than, like, when I say, rather than use, like you said, what, SCCF, use this as part of, like,
Yeah, so, and by default, of course, when you install Choco, there's it has different sources. So there's a default one, is the chocolatey one, which points to the official one. But you can add your own source as well. So if you have like this ProGet server, or if you install the chocolatey server, which is just an IIS web application, then you can host stuff internally. So as part of this bootstrapping thing, what you would do is you install chocolatey, you most likely get rid of the chocolatey default, or you disable that one, and then you add your internal feeds. And then once you say then from that point on, every time you say Choco install Chrome, it uses the package you have published on your internal feed. And what you do with this Choco NuGet package on your internal one is up to you. You can still pull the actual MSI file from the internet, but you could also pull it from an internal server. Which of course makes sense in most environments where you want to make sure you have this internally. And what I wanted to get to is that I'm not part of the company, or I'm not selling it. There is a business version of it. I just wanted to highlight it. And the business version has a tool which they give you, a package internalizer. So you can basically, I haven't used it myself because I'm not business, I don't have a business license, but as I understand it, you basically point it to the package on the official repo, and then also give it an internal URL, and it makes sure it changes the NuGet package in a way that it uses your internal source, it downloads the MSI or XE or whatever, and then it uploads it to your internal repo. So as I said before, you could code this yourself.
Yeah.
As you saw, it is a zip file. You could open the zip file.
Yeah.
You maybe drop in a different PowerShell file, or just with some search and replace.
Yeah.
You replace the strings, and then you package it. You zip it again.
Yeah.
Especially with PowerShell version 5, where you can create zip files really easily.
Yeah.
Super easy job. So you don't need to splash out for what for the business version. You can create this
thing to do it, like
yeah. and there are other tools as well. Some of them are the package extensions and stuff. So there's some tools which are in the free version, but there's some stuff which they ask you for money, which isn't a lot anyway. I mean, if you look at the pricing, if you really depend on this tool, it's...
I think it's more of a licensing thing than price from a corporate perspective. Kind of making sure if I install this, I'm not going to get in trouble. I like it.
Cool. Awesome. Cool. Thanks for your time. Then I hope you enjoyed tonight as well. Please tell your friends and colleagues who are also in tech space. I would like to grow this a bit more.
Yeah.
And if you have any topics which you would like us to cover, or if you have some ideas what you might want to present, because for example, for this presentation, I invested maybe like 3 hours to prepare for it. Of course, I I knew about the tool, but I hadn't looked into the source code. I mean, I knew about the concept of how to get a PowerShell host into the application because I've used it previously. But the actual research and putting this together, it was about 3 hours. So it doesn't need to take a lot of time to do a presentation in front of everyone.
Yeah.
And this one is quite long. But you could do like 10, 15 minutes, share something, as I say, in 2 months' time, share your universal dashboard.
I'm going to do it. I've said it.
Good. Awesome.
I committed. And you know what I said I'm going to do? I'm going to do it.
Yeah, so it can be anything. It doesn't need to be very long. And so it can be really anything. And we have a YouTube channel. It's called the UK DevOps Collective, and I'm starting to publish videos there from especially the London meetups, and because this one is recorded, we are going to publish these sessions here as well. So you can go through these sessions and see what's happening in London, for example, and get some additional knowledge and exposure to different things. Cool. Thank you so much for coming. That's been a pleasure.